Yeah, Sam said, my name's Chad Sanders. I'm happy to be with you this morning. It's my pleasure. The connection for me with this church is that Dan is good friends with the senior pastor at my church, Dennis Turner, at New Life Community Church in Fredericktown, which is an Alliance church down there. That's our connection. Dan also told me he has a history at North Woodbury Alliance. And we also have a connection there. Our oldest daughter, who's 22, she's the church secretary at North Woodbury Alliance. So while I may not know you, I feel like there's a connection. There's all this connection amongst the Alliance churches, and so it's good to just get to know you, get to know some Christian brothers and sisters, or brothers and sisters in Christ, and someone new. And you know, I try not to ever turn down a opportunity to speak, because for me, I believe it's an opportunity to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. And in fact, I have this conviction that the gospel is more than just maybe what we think of as an opportunity to get out of jail free type thing, more than just our ticket out of hell, but it really transforms and intersects with all areas of life. And so I love to tell churches about that. And I've learned in my own life how the gospel changes and informs everything that we do. One of my favorite authors is a man named J.I. Packer. And he says, he has this quote that I say often, so you don't know me, so you've never heard me say this. But I say this often. But J.I. Packer says, you never get away from the gospel. You just go deeper into it. And that's what I believe. I want to just share kind of a testimony of how God has taken me deeper into the gospel over just the last few months. I serve off and on at New Life Community Church. I've been an elder there for years. I preach and teach at times. But during my day job, by the way, this is my entourage is over here, right there. There's my wife and two of my four children, and then our friends Dave and Sherry, who worship with us and live next door to us. So get talk to them at the end. They can tell you all kinds of interesting things about me, I'm sure. During the day, though, I do a job that maybe is new for you, maybe you've never heard of, but I'm a forester. And I manage forests. I went to college to learn how to be a forester and a wildlife biologist. And I've worked in different states, but I work right now at Mohican State Forest. Have you been to Mohican State Forest?
Yes.
You know all about it. Since you live in Mansfield, you might also get the Mansfield News Journal. So maybe now you're starting to put two and two together of who I am, because I've been in the paper for the last 3 or 4 months. Have you seen me in the newspaper? Don't go back and look. So for the last 3 or 4 months, since about August, I've been in the Mansfield News Journal more times than I care to want to be. Okay. I don't like the spotlight. You know, you can imagine somebody who wants to be a forester and work in the woods does not really want to be in front of people. And so, but I've been the focus of this controversy at Mohican State Forest, because some of the things I'm proposing to do there involve harvesting trees and logging. Sometimes that's controversial. So there's some people in Mansfield right here that's very much against that and have really stirred up the media. And so I've been in 4 or 5 newspapers all across the state, Columbus Dispatch, Mansfield News Journal. I'm in the paper often. I'm quite famous. I'm not on Facebook. One time I got on Facebook and read all kinds of nasty things about myself that people are posting. There's this real campaign, and it can be very hateful, contentious. You know, people are in my face saying, you're a liar, arguing with me. And I've been in constant meetings. I've been meetings with legislators in Columbus. Constant interviews with media, the radio, radio and newspaper mostly, social media people. I don't understand all that, but Anyways, you can imagine that's a burden. That is hard for me. I didn't realize there was people up there. It's a burden to be part of that controversy, and it's a burden. Maybe you have a burden at work. It's a burden to go into work, and you know you're in the frying pan. It's controversy. It's headache. You're constantly on edge. Your stress level, your blood pressure's high. But during the same time, I had other burdens as well. I had burdens at home. And I don't want to get into all the details, but you know, I would come home from work, and there's this burden at home this fall. And not just a burden at home, I had a burden at work, at church. You know, church is a place you feel like, you know, you get recharged on a Sunday. You leave your busy work life, your stress, you come to church and you recharge, you get reacquainted with Jesus. But for me, church at New Life, there's been some burdens, some controversies, some difficulties, some interpersonal things. At church, so I had these three burdens. Really, everywhere I went, I go to work, there's this burden. I go to church, there's this burden. I come home, you know, you want to come home, and come home, there's this burden. I kind of pride myself that I can handle burdens pretty well, you know, handle that. And except when there's more than one, and then I start realizing I really can't handle all these burdens. In fact, I can't really handle any of them very well. It's my own sinful pride that thinks I can handle these burdens and stresses, controversies. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Do you have burdens in your life? I see some head. Just, I have a burden. Yeah, I mean, and not for me, but just to God. I have a burden. I think most people do. How do you deal with your burdens of your life? How well do you handle them? Well, when I was going through all of this, I believe God gave me this passage. I want to share it with you today. So if you turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 11, turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through 30. Would you stand, please, for the reading of God's Word? Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through 30. This is from the ESV. The Lord Jesus says, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." This is the word of the Lord. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we come to you in the name of Jesus, and we thank you that it was your good pleasure to reveal these things to little children, even us. I pray, Lord, that the Holy Spirit would reveal these words into our hearts. May we recognize our great need for Jesus, and may we surrender to him. It's in his name, for his sake, that I pray. Amen. Amen. So I realized, I was going to work one morning. I had a long drive, and I was up early. I was just reading in my normal place where I read, and I have in the Bible that morning, and it was in Matthew. And I come across this scripture, and it was just like God, I just melted. And I felt like God gave me that scripture. So I put this whole sermon together that morning as I was driving to work, just in my head. You know, I started breaking it down and started putting it together. And by the time I got to work, I felt like I had this sermon. And the next time I preached was sometime in November. I preached this at New Life. And so when I was asked to preach here today, I thought, I have this sermon. Because just by the show of hands and the heads nodding, everybody deals with burdens. And how do you deal with it? Do you think to go to Jesus? See, that's what I realized. In fact, I had my wife to think about this. I came home for one day from a really hard day at work of all these media inquiries and all these people who hate my guts. all these people just really down on me, and I came home and I was telling my wife, you know, I really can't handle all these things right now. And she says, well, have you talked to Jesus about that? And I was like, well, no. I have, well, why not? So I read this passage. I begin to just talk to Jesus. I want you to pretend, this is going to sound really blasphemous, but pretend for a moment. Imagine that Jesus is a real person. Sounds terrible to say it that way, right? Because he is a real person, we know that. But do you live as if Jesus is a real person? I believe he really exists. I believe that he wants to have a relationship with us. And I want to have a relationship with him. I believe he exists right now physically. Like he really is somewhere in heaven. At the right hand of the Father is what the Bible tells us. I believe this about Jesus. I started thinking about there's a whole many things that I believe about Jesus. I believe that he spoke the universe into existence. That he named the day and the night. That he created man and he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. He created space and time and the laws of physics and gravity. And since he created those things, he stands outside of them so he can enter into them at any time he wants. So for him, the past is the future and the future is the past. He's not governed by these things because he created them. Job has some of the most wonderful language on this, if you've read the book of Job. He says that that God commands the lightning, that he tells the morning when to come, that he tells the mountain goats when to give birth, that he holds the hail and the snow and the rain in great storehouses, and he tells them when to come. He's the everlasting God. The creator of all the earth, he never grows weak or wearied, and we know this. We know that Jesus came to earth supernaturally born of a virgin. I mean, that's impossible. And he performed great signs and wonders, and people rejected him. And they persecuted him, and they crucified him, and he died, but he rose from the dead. Where he sits to this day at the right hand of the Father, and I believe one day we will see him. Do you believe that? Amen. It's okay to say amen if you believe it. Amen. I believe we'll see him. I believe when we see him, we'll notice things about him that the Bible tells us. We'll see his hair. His hair is as white as snow. We'll see his eyes, the Bible says, are like flames of fire. And there's a sharp two-edged sword that comes from his mouth. And there's many crowns on his head. And his face is like looking at full strength into the sun. And he's wearing a robe dipped in blood. And on his robe and on his thigh are written King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I believe that. When I was just a young boy, the Holy Spirit convinced me of that. He changed my heart. And so I put my faith and trust in Jesus Christ. I confessed with my mouth that Jesus was Lord. I believed in my heart that God raised him from the dead, and I was saved. So why then do I think I can carry my own burdens? I realize I can't really carry any of them. I realize it's my sinful pride that thinks I can carry it. That I'm delusional because we have technology. We have all the things at our fingertips. That we feel like we don't need God because we have it all figured out. We have all the conveniences of the world right at our fingertips. I had a good friend that I went to seminary with. He grew up in Africa. And he spent his whole life there. And when he was a late teenager, his family moved to Chicago. And that's where he is today. And he says that, you know, when we were in Africa, every night we would gather at the kitchen table and we would pray, God, you know, help us with the water. Because tomorrow, you know, this family needs water. And Lord, help us with these sicknesses because, you know, the hospital is dozens and dozens of miles away. We don't have doctors here, so help us with the sicknesses. And Lord, this family needs food, so help us with the food. I mean, the basic needs of life. and every day they prayed for. But he says when they came to Chicago, all the basic needs of life were right there. And he said they would gather at the kitchen table at night, and he says he remembers his mom and dad looking at each other in panic almost. What do we pray for? We have everything we need. They didn't recognize their great need for Jesus, right? It's just a masquerade because that you have all that you need, that you still don't need Jesus. You still need Jesus. You have to recognize your great need for him. I want to tell you, the key to burden bearing and to all of life is this personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Okay, that's what the message today is about. So look at your Bibles. Matthew 11, 28 through 30. I want you to see three things from that passage. Three things why that the key to burden bearing and all of life is the relationship with Jesus Christ. The first is this, if you're taking notes, It's that Jesus invites us to a personal relationship with him. Look at verse 28. Verse 28 says, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." That's an invitation from Jesus. An invitation to a relationship. Don't forget something here, my friends. The most central tenet of Christianity is a relationship with a person, Jesus Christ, right? It's about this person, Jesus Christ. That's the central thing. That's what makes us different from all other religions, is that we believe it's about a person, our relationship with him. That's what it's all about. Notice, more importantly than what's maybe there, but what's not there in that verse 28, when Jesus says, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden." He never offers, there's no plan there. There's no procedure. There's no protocol. There's no system. There's no scheme. There's no mechanism. It's like he's offering himself as the answer, isn't it? See, that's different than every other religion. Every other religion is going to offer you a plan, a protocol, a procedure, a mechanism. If you walk into the door of any other worship facility that's not a Christian facility, you'll say, "I have these burdens, what do I do?" They're going to offer you a plan. This is what you need to do. A procedure. Here's a mechanism that you need to go through, work out these steps. But Jesus says, "I'm the answer." Himself. Personally, it's his personal self that's the answer to your problems. Not a plan, not a procedure, not a protocol. Let me take a sidebar here. There's a false teaching that's pervasive in America. It's called the prosperity gospel. Or the word faith movement. Have you heard of this? So if you don't know what I'm talking about, if you go to the religion channels on your TVs, most of those guys, or if you walk into the Christian bookstore and you see the books that are best sellers and they got somebody's, you know, 2 feet grin on the front of the cover, it's probably one of those guys. If you ask them, "What's the solution to my problems?" They'll say, "Well, you need to follow this recipe." And the recipe is you need to think positive thoughts. You need to say positive things. You need to have more faith. If you don't have enough faith, you still have a problem, it's because you don't have enough faith, so you need to build your faith. That's not what Jesus says. He says, "Come to me personally." He's the answer. He invites those who labor and are heavy laden with burdens. So what are these burdens? Who are these people who have burdens? Well, they're people just like us. They're people who have everyday burdens. They're people who have religious burdens. That's probably the context here in Matthew. The Pharisees would lay up heavy burdens, burdens of performance, that you need to do these religious activities. Jesus says, "No, it's not about that." He says, "Pharisees, you're laying up heavy burdens on people that they can't bear." So it's those kind of people. It's maybe burdens that are laid upon you. Like, it says those who labor and are heavy laden. And I think of heavy laden as people who have burdens laid upon them that they didn't really ask for. So you probably didn't ask for your cancer, right? It was just laid upon you. Probably didn't ask for the remorse and the heartache that comes from the death of a loved one, for example. Those are burdens that are laid upon you. But it's all in the context of the biggest burden of all that we have. It's the burden of our death, our sin, and our guilt. This is a burden that you are born with, and yet you are 100% accountable for. This is a burden that you cannot bear on your own. In fact, if you try to bear the burden of your own sin, guilt, and death by yourself, it's a path to eternal damnation. Jesus here tells us, come to me with your burden, and he will bear it. He's bore the burden of our sin, guilt, and death on the cross. And therefore, he can bear any of our burdens. I should take a deep breath with me. Take a deep breath. Feels good to breathe. Right? Take another deep breath. Feels good. You know, when you breathe, a complicated set of chemical and physiological processes happen in your body. There's a vacuum that forms and air is sucked into your lungs, and oxygen molecules are broken apart and absorbed into the cells, and they go and feed out your whole body. So when you breathe, it feels good. You need to breathe. Breathing is a good idea, especially when you're sleeping. One thing about breathing is sometimes we're delusional to think that we control our own breathing, right? So I can decide to take a breath. I just took a breath. But I don't have to remember to breathe. That's good. Because I would forget if I had to remember, especially when you're sleeping. So breathing is one of these interesting things that is being controlled by someone else. Jesus Christ, and yet you have the ability to breathe, so you think that you can control it. So he really bears the burden of your breathing, doesn't he? You don't bear the burden of your breathing. That's a good deal. If you had to bear the burden of your breathing, you would forget to breathe sometimes. So you can't control even the simplest thing in life, breathing. The Lord Jesus Christ controls that. And even breathing during sleeping, I was thinking about sleeping. You know, sleeping, that'll blow your mind too. Think about sleeping. Think about what happens when you sleep. You know, on one hand, your body completely shuts down. On the other hand, it's regenerating itself, and all kinds of new things happen when you sleep. And toxins are cleaned out of your brain, and other parts of your body kick into motion when you sleep, and yet your body's kind of shut down. In sleeping, you're unconscious. And yet, you're not dead. You're still alive, very much alive. In sleeping, you don't have to think about anything, but you continue to breathe, your heart beats, your brain functions. I mean, sleeping is amazing. It'll blow your mind. I think it blew the psalmist's mind, David. In Psalm chapter 3, he concludes, I slept and I awoke because God sustained me. That's all he can conclude. And in Psalm chapter 3, it seems like he says, read Psalm chapter 3. It seems like he says that all of the problems in his life are really no big deal. All of his enemies are really no big deal because I slept and I awoke and God sustained me. So if he can sustain me while I sleep, he can take care of all these other burdens. Jesus is really the one who's bearing your burdens. He bore the burden of your breathing. He bore the burden of your sin on the cross. He sees your burden now, whatever you're going through. Whether you're having marriage problems, whether you have cancer, whether you have children that you're dealing with, you have a work situation like I do, he sees it and he can bear it. He knows how to do that. So he invites you to this relationship. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden. This is basically recognizing your great need for him, right? It's just a recognizing your great need. I need Jesus to breathe. I need Jesus to bear my burden of my sin and death. I need him every day through my work, my home, my church, whatever I'm dealing with. I need him. Okay, so that's the invitation. The second thing is this. Jesus invites us to be his disciple. Verse 29, Jesus invites us to be his disciple. First, he invites us to salvation. He invites us to be his disciple. Verse 29, take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Jesus invites us to be his disciple. He invites us, kind of a two-part thing here. Take his yoke and learn from me. This is, I think what he's saying here is be my disciple. You know, discipleship and salvation go hand in hand. You really can't have one without the other. The first part, come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden. That's the invitation to salvation. Here, take my yoke and learn from me. That's the discipleship part. They go hand in hand. So, I have a question for you. Jesus says, take my yoke. And I asked myself this when Jesus gave me this passage, and I was reading it, and I was studying it, putting it together. I thought, why do I need another yoke? I have plenty of yokes right now. Burdens. Isn't a yoke a burden? He says, take my yoke. Why do I need another yoke? You ever feel that way? What's he saying? Well, many people that I've read think that this is an animal yoke. And, you know, you have this image of an animal yoke, like a yoke of oxen, where you have this wooden thing that goes over one animal, goes over the other animal, and you're pulling the load together. And so I've read commentators that say, you know, this is an animal yoke. So like you're on one side of the burden, and Jesus, you're yoked to Jesus, and you're pulling together. I don't think it's that way at all. I think that breaks down just the logic of it. That one, we're not an animal, so, you know, why would we wear an animal yoke? And two, there's no way that I'm pulling equally with Jesus. There's no way that I'm doing any contribution to this burden sharing that Jesus is doing. So I think rather it's more of a human yoke. And you'll see these in other cultures. You don't see them often here. But in other cultures, maybe you've seen, if you were trying to carry two buckets, in other cultures, sometimes you see this yoke that a person would wear over their shoulders. And you would hook maybe a bucket or a load here, and a bucket, and it makes the burden easier. Have you seen those? Built for a human. I think that's what he's saying. He's saying, be my disciple. My yoke, take my yoke upon you, because it helps carry the burdens, right? I mean, imagine that you've carried a heavy bucket before. You carry a heavy bucket, it feels like, you know, it's wanting to pull your fingers off. And if you carry two, you ever carry two heavy buckets at the same time, maybe to your garden or your flower beds or something, and it feels like you want to pull your arms out of your sockets. But if you have that yoke, right, distributes the load, you can carry that. Everybody's carrying burdens around, like buckets, right? What do you carry? What do you carry in your heavy bucket? You know, some people carry their past around as a burden, like a heavy bucket, you know, and you can tell that they're carrying their past around. You can tell they're carrying their past around because it comes up in conversation often, that they'll bring up their past. And often when I hear that from people, I think to myself, they're still carrying their past around. Take my yoke, he says. It makes the burden easier. It's the yoke of submission. Jesus is asking us to be his disciples. So it's the yoke of submission. It's the yoke of surrender. I feel like I need to talk about the church here. And this, when I wrote this, I'm thinking about my church in Fredericktown. But maybe you can find some application here. But oftentimes in serving at a church, it's all about what you need to do more. That these are the things that we need to do here in church. We need to be missional, or we need to, I've heard small groups mention music ministry, all these different ministries, and we're hustling to be a part of those ministries. But that's heavy burdens that you can't bear unless you have that relationship with Jesus. Remember, Jesus says, take my yoke of submission. And I wonder sometimes if what we do at church is missing the Jesus part, missing the discipleship of Jesus part, and just thereby it's just becoming work. It's just becoming heavy loads that we bear without Jesus. So that's the yoke part. The second part is, he says, learn from me. Learn from me. So when I hear Jesus say, learn from me, I automatically ask the question, what are you teaching? Right? You have to learn from a teacher. So it would be nice if I knew what Jesus' teachings were, right? If I'm going to learn from a teacher, what's the teaching? So where's the teachings? Well, they're right here. Right? I'm being facetious. Here's the teachings of Jesus. He says, learn from me. This is how to be the disciple, the Bible. I just want to say a couple things about the Bible. You know, part of any good relationship is communication. So if you're married, having good communication with your spouse is part of that relationship, right? I wouldn't be a very good spouse if I didn't listen to my wife, or that she didn't listen to me, so we communicate. Remember, we have this personal relationship with Jesus. He's a real person. And so the two-way communication works like this. When we pray, that's our communication to God. And when we read Scripture, that's His communication back to us, right? Do you believe this is the Word of God?
Amen.
Do you believe it? When's the last time you read it? It's God's Word. When's the last time you gave any part of it to anyone? It's God's Word. You know, if it's God's Word, then when we read it, we may just encounter God here on the pages. You know, in many statements of faith, churches will say that this Bible is sufficient for faith and practice, something like that. I think it's more than that. I believe you can actually encounter God here, Jesus. You can have an encounter with Jesus Christ right here on the pages of Scripture. I worry that we treat the Bible as a policy manual. Have you ever read a policy manual? I work for the government, the state of Ohio. We have policy manuals. I have dozens of policy manuals. They line my desk, all these three-ring. They're usually three-ring binders. They're about this thick. No one's ever read them. I've written policy manuals. I've written them that no one's read. We have policy manuals for everything. We have policy manuals on what you're to wear to work. We have policy manuals on how to operate a motor vehicle. We have policy manuals on how to use a credit card. You have to read the policy manual. Now, policy manuals are great. When you don't know what to do, you look at the policy manual, right? I worry that we treat Scripture that way. It's a policy manual. You know, it's there. It's there in our Bible studies. It's there in our elder meetings. When we don't know what to do, let's go to the policy manual, check it out. But it's so much more than that. Don't make it a policy manual. No one reads the policy manual. Here you can encounter Jesus Christ. Make it about that. Make it more than just an instruction book. No, who reads the instructions? No one reads the instructions. Don't call it an instruction book. I've heard people use that acronym Bible, B-I-B-L-E, basic instructions before leaving Earth. I mean, it's cute, but don't say that. No one reads the instruction manual, so don't call it an instruction manual. It's the Word of God. I saw small groups in your bulletin this morning. I heard Sam talk about small groups. When I spoke with Dan on the phone, he mentioned small groups. So it sounds like small groups is a big deal. Right now, let me give you some advice. Structure your small groups around two things. The Word of God and prayer. Those two things. That's the relationship with Jesus Christ. Your communication with Him, His communication with you. And you structure your small groups around that communication, two-way communication with Jesus Christ. And that's what your small group will be about. Now, there's all kinds of other things you can do in a small group. And I'm not picking on them. You know, there's games and food and fellowship and all of these things, community. I mean, and they're fine. But don't sacrifice the relationship the prayer and the Bible study. Structure and fight for it. I've led small groups for years. I've led many of them. I've attended many of them. We've had times where, you know, we would get in there and we hadn't seen each other all month, and we get to gabbing, you know, we get to talking, and people, somebody's going through something, and they'll get to crying, and then we get to talking, and all that's good. But then the kids get fussy, and then it's time to go home, and we didn't pray, and we didn't read the Bible or study, and we miss that communication. We miss that learn from me that Jesus says. So structure, so be vigilant to fight for it. So what we did in our small groups is the men started taking a day once a month to go meet as men and eat wings and burp and be men and to talk about men things. And the women had days where they got together and, you know, they did whatever they do, and they talk about women things. But when we got together in small groups, we tried to read and study and pray. Because that, we structured it around it, because that's the Jesus part of it. Don't forget the personal relationship with Jesus. It's a willingness to surrender. It's a willingness to surrender to Jesus. Look at verse 29 again. Remember, Jesus says here, I'm gentle and I'm lowly in heart. You know, I think it's his way of saying that, you know, I have no obligation to invite you to be my disciple. I am the creator of the universe. I control all things. In fact, he says that in verse 27. Just look back. All things have been handed over to me by my Father. He's in charge of all things, and yet he has divine compassion on us. It's his way of saying he's the king of the universe. He has divine compassion. I am gentle and lowly in heart. So come to me. I will accept you. I know what you're going through, is what he's saying. I know the burden that you're carrying right now. I'm gentle and lowly in heart. Come to me. I will receive you, he's saying. Would you turn the Bible just over? I just want to show you kind of how this works in Isaiah 57. It said very, very similar way, Isaiah 57, verse 15. God says this, Isaiah writes this in verse 15. He says, thus says the one who is high and lifted up, who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy. He says, I dwell in the high and holy place, and also with him who is of contrite and lowly spirit, to revive the spirit of the lowly and to revive the heart of the contrite. In other words, he's up here in heaven. He created everything. He's high and holy, and yet he comes down. He's gentle and humble in heart to receive us. That's the discipleship part. The third part is this. Jesus has promised blessings when we enter into him. So there's this invitation to salvation, an invitation to be a disciple, and there's this promised blessing. And see it in verse 28. He says, I will give you rest. Verse 29, you will find rest for your souls, he says. What is this rest? Well, I think Jesus is maybe referring back to the Old Testament and prophet Jeremiah in chapter 6, verse 16. Jeremiah says, follow the ancient paths and you will find rest for your souls. Kind of very similar to what Jesus is saying, you will find rest for your souls. What Jeremiah is saying is, you know, you've fallen away from worshiping Yahweh, the covenant God. You've gotten away from following the Ten Commandments. Follow the ancient paths and you'll find rest for your souls. What Jesus is saying is, come to me, I'm God. Be my disciple, follow and worship me. You will find rest for your souls. Well, what's the rest? Well, I believe it's a number of things. It's enjoying God's presence. It's a peace. There's a sense of justice in this rest. A sense of justice that Jesus is one day going to make all things right. That the injustice you're going through today and your suffering, that Jesus is going to fix that someday. But more importantly, I think it has to do with our eternal rest in eternity with Jesus. By comparison, all other things are nothing. right? The Apostle Paul says it very similar. He says, I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing to the future glory that will be revealed. Romans chapter 8. Jesus says, come to me and you will find rest for your souls. It's not a promise that your suffering goes away. It's a promise that one day he's going to make it all right. He's going to make it all new in eternity. And you'll look back and say, it doesn't even compare with what I have now. Notice the final verse there. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. This relationship, this access to him, he says, it's easy and light. Well, what does he mean there by easy and light? Well, please don't misunderstand this again, like the prosperity preachers might say, that when you follow Jesus, your suffering goes away. And so following Jesus is easy and light. Is that true? Is your suffering going away? It's not true on the face of it. It's ridiculous. In fact, Jesus has just come off of telling a whole bunch of things about suffering. We're in Matthew chapter 11. Just look one page back, Matthew chapter 10. The whole chapter's about suffering. He sends out the disciples. He sends out, tells them all this persecution. Behold, verse 16, I'm sending you out as sheep among wolves. He says in verse 21, brothers will deliver brothers over to death, and fathers, child, and children will rise against their parents and have them put to death. Verse 28, do not fear those who can kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body. Verse 34, do not think that I've come to bring peace on earth. I've come not to bring peace but a sword. Verse 38, whoever does not take up his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. In other words, he's promising suffering, persecution, heartache, tribulation. He promises that. So what is this easy and light business about? Well, I think, you know, I can't pretend to make sense of evil and suffering in this world in light of this verse that his burden is easy and light. I'll just say it this way. I think we need to see it in light of the cross. I think we need to see our burdens in light of the burden that Jesus bore on the cross. The burden of our sin, our guilt, our death is our cross. Sometimes I say, point to the cross if there's a cross behind you and look at it. Just imagine, imagine your Savior hanging there with your sin and death on his shoulders. Picture our Lord suffering this great burden laid upon him, a burden that you could not bear. As the prophet says, surely he bore our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. I think that's what burden, my burden is easy, easy and light means. I think it's by comparison. The burdens that you bear are no comparison to what Jesus bore on the cross for you, because he loves you, because he invites you to a relationship with him. His yoke is easy and his burden is light because he's really in control and we're not, right? We recognize that he actually controls our burdens, whether it's a burden at work, at home, or in this church. He's in control of that. He bears it. So by comparison, what we bear is easy and light. want to bring this back to your church for a second. You talked about small groups. One thing in small groups that's really important is burden sharing with each other. I see that in the name of your church is community, Community Bible Church, right? So in community, we bear each other's burdens. You know what the basis for that is, right? It's the burden bearing of Jesus. He bore our burdens on the cross. When we recognize what he did for us, it's a lot easier to help someone else bear their burdens. So I want to conclude by saying this. I'll invite the musicians up here. We're going to sing one final song. You know, I don't know how you do things here, but I just thought it'd be good to just give you just a few minutes an opportunity to respond to this message. There's kind of two main things of this message, is recognizing your great need for Jesus and then be willing to surrender to him. And so I thought, as we sing this final song, I'm not going to ask you to do anything weird. But isn't this passage an invitation? Jesus says, come to me. So I want to invite you to come to Jesus this morning. So maybe that could be a number of ways. Maybe you want to find someone to pray with. I just want to open it up a little bit. Maybe you're bearing a burden in your marriage and you know there's a couple here that can help you and you want to go pray with them. And it's okay to get out of your seat and go over and pray with this couple. Maybe you know someone who's carrying a burden right now of cancer or of their children or some health issue, and maybe you want to go do some burden bearing with them and pray with them. I want to invite you to do that. I want to say it's okay to get up out of your seat and to go pray, to respond to this message. The most important thing, though, is this. As Jesus showed me during the time of burdens that I had, that I need to come to him, that I need to go deeper into the gospel, I want to make sure you understand this. Jesus bore the burden of your sin on the cross, and he invites you to a personal relationship with him. And if you have never responded by coming to him, I want to say don't leave here today without doing that. So after this message is over, I'll be standing over in this corner, and I can talk to you. I would love to talk to you. If you've never come to Jesus, you can come over there and talk to me. And I'll show you how you can just respond to Jesus by receiving his gospel. Would you stand as we sing this last song, please? Thank you. Prays here, Matthew 11. It says, at that time Jesus declared, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and understanding and revealed them to little children. That's us. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Let me pray. Father, we thank you, for such was your gracious will to choose us and to reveal your Son to us. Jesus, help us to remember to come to you with our burdens and to take your yoke upon us. And you've promised, Lord, that your yoke is easy and your burden is light. Thank you for what you've done on the cross. May it inform and transform our lives in all that we do and say. It's in your name I pray. Amen.